The spark gap transmitter is a type of wireless telegraph. It's very difficult for a spark gap transmitter, for example, to transmit voice or any kind of complicated signal, but it's very easy for it to transmit Morse code, and that's primarily how the spark gap transmitter was actually used. The spark gap transmitter is either on or off, and it's operated by a single switch. And the same switch that turns the circuit on or off is also the switch used to send the Morse code. It's shown here in this diagram in the open position. The main difference between the diagram that you're seeing now and the transmitter that we described in the previous video is that the motorized switch between capacitors C1 and C2 has been replaced with a spark gap. A spark gap is nothing more than two electrodes that are placed a few millimeters apart. If you imagine hooking up a battery like a 1-volt battery or a 9-volt battery to two electrodes just in air, nothing's going to happen. No current's going to flow through these two electrodes. But if you could somehow generate a spark between two electrodes that are placed a certain distance apart, then you could get current to flow. Anytime you see a spark or a bolt of lightning, for instance, what you're seeing is a plasma, and a plasma is a conducting channel. So if we can generate a spark between two electrodes, then we can conduct current through the spark channel. To generate a spark, we need a very high voltage. Obviously, a 1.5-volt battery or a 9-volt battery or even a 90-volt battery is not going to be enough. So although in the diagram it looks like I have an ordinary battery drawn, we're going to need something a lot bigger. We need something like 10,000 volts. So for the time being, let's imagine that I've got a 10,000-volt battery hooked up to this circuit. With a spark gap, if you have the electrodes placed closer together, then the voltage needed to break down the air is not going to be as high as it would be if the electrodes were placed a little bit further apart. But there's limits to how close the electrodes could be, and then obviously you don't want them too far apart either. With the switch open, no current flows anywhere in the circuit, so that makes the situation very easy to understand. So in order to describe how the spark gap transmitter works, let's consider the situation when the Morse switch is closed. As soon as I close the switch and we imagine an initial condition where neither of the two capacitors are charged, then we have 0 volts across the capacitors and current is going to flow out of the battery through resistor R and C1 will be charged. Now at this point in time, none of the current from the battery is going to flow over through the spark gap because initially C1 and C2 are both at the same 0 initial voltage. And with 0 voltage across the spark gap, we're not going to create a spark. So capacitor C1 is going to charge. Now, the amount of time it takes C1 to charge is obviously going to depend on how big of a resistor the current has to flow through and how big capacitor C1 is. Let me draw a graph of the voltage across C1 as a function of time. Initially, there's no voltage across the capacitor at the moment the Morse switch is closed. But then the capacitor starts to charge exponentially, and eventually, as capacitor C1 starts to charge, the voltage would approach the battery voltage. And if we didn't have any spark gap in the circuit, we would get infinitely close to the battery voltage in the ideal case. Now, what will actually happen, however, in the circuit is that eventually VC1 will start to get very high. And once we exceed the breakdown voltage of air across the spark gap, then the air will break down and we'll start to have current flow from capacitor C1 down into capacitor C2, where the initial voltage is just 0. So let's now alter our graph a little bit to describe that situation. If we assume that the breakdown voltage across this particular spark gap is, say, 10,000 volts. So in that case, the battery would have to be a little bit bigger than that. So once we hit 10,000 volts, then the spark gap will break down and capacitor C1 will very quickly discharge into capacitor C2 until these capacitors are at equal voltages. At this point, we now have the tank circuit charged up. Once capacitor C1 has been discharged, then the air in the spark gap will no longer be able to sustain the spark, and then capacitor C1 will start to charge up again, and the cycle will repeat. So we'll eventually end up with some signal across capacitor C1 that corresponds to the sparking frequency, where we get a spark every time the capacitor C1 discharges into capacitor C2. The time it takes for capacitor C1 to discharge into C2, of course, depends on the specific values of the capacitors that I choose, but typically this would be very fast compared to the amount of time that C1 charges through resistor R. During the time where a capacitor C1 is charging and there's no spark, we now have pumped energy into our tank circuit, and then that can radiate away through the antenna in a sine wave which slowly decays. So what we hope is that the sparks happen often enough to continuously pump enough energy into our tank circuit in order to get a roughly continuous amount of power radiated out of the antenna. Now, the circuit that I've just drawn is not the optimal way to arrange the components in a spark gap transmitter, but I've chosen this particular configuration because I think it's pedagogically useful and this circuit is not very difficult to understand. We are, however, missing some important details about impedance matching with the antenna, and I've left off one additional very important detail, and that's how can we create a 10,000 volt battery? They don't actually exist.